Today, we are heading off planet Earth and going to the moon. The moon is back in vogue again, whether it's the United States or China or billionaires. Lots of people seem to want to go there. And we're going to talk to a person named Jessy Kate Schingler. She's worked at NASA Ames. She's worked at a rocket company. And she is part of an organization called Open Lunar. It's a nonprofit, and they're doing something that's really interesting, rethinking different ways that we might govern and set up settlements on the moon, and maybe find a way to do things better and at least differently on the moon than we have on Earth. With that, we are going to go to France, where Jessy Kate is spending a little COVID time. Well, thanks for doing this with us. Can you, for people who don't know about the Open Lunar Foundation, can you tell us what the mission is?
Yeah, Open Lunar is interested in seeing a peaceful and cooperative, sustained human presence on the moon, and ensuring that that happens in a way that is open and accessible and, as soon as possible.
I'm not sure that if you're just a casual observer of all this stuff, that people are fully aware of how much reinvigorated interest there is in the moon right now. Tell me, if we think globally, what's going on between China and the U.S. and various factions trying to get to the moon in the next few years?
The United States has been and continues to be one of the major players in the space industry. It has a program called the Artemis program that is focused on getting humans back to the moon for the first time since the Apollo program. During the Apollo program, Russia, of course, was the major other player in the space world. And that introduced a dynamic that was, a Cold War dynamic where Russia and the United States were competing for getting to the moon first. Today, what we see is something that has some analogs to that between the United States and China, who is the other major state actor in the space world. China also has plans to go to the lunar surface with humans, with taikonauts. And both the United States and China have plans to set up a base of some kind or an outpost on the lunar surface. But of course, they're not the only ones interested in going to the lunar surface. There are a lot of other countries who are developing capabilities either to collaborate with those countries or to send their own missions. And then there are private actors who are planning to go to the lunar surface. Of course, everybody's familiar with SpaceX and Blue Origin at this point, and they're companies that have leadership with a very strong vision for seeing a sustained human presence on the lunar surface.
And then, if you go back 10 years ago, right when SpaceX was kind of starting to hit its stride and Bezos was putting a lot of money into Blue Origin. It seemed like Mars, Elon's very focused on Mars, and Mars was like the talk. And obviously there's things you can do there that you can't do on the moon. But it's kind of funny. The moon just sort of came back in vogue very quickly. It felt like to me, why do you think that is if you do think that's what actually kind of happened?
Yeah, in the space community, of course, we love to debate moon versus Mars, and it's fun, and they're very different places, and there are a lot of reasons for us to go to Mars, but the moon is much closer, and it's somewhere that we can go and sort of learn the ropes of having human presence, an extended human presence in outer space. We can get our transportation systems in order, we can get our human habitation systems in order, our communication systems in order. So, I think most folks with a kind of long-term vision for space exploration and settlement in general would see them not as being in competition with one another, but the moon as being a stepping stone to Mars and other kinds of activities, and just building on our presence on the moon. Hopefully what we'll see is the development of sustained human presence on the moon and going to Mars.
And I wanted to get into a little bit about why you're so into the moon and space in general. You have a pretty interesting history when it comes to all this. Tell me a little bit about how you got into all this.
Yeah, so I guess I'll say that that I actually wasn't your typical kid who was into space. I never had this sort of grand vision of being an astronaut. I wasn't a nerd about rockets. And I actually ended up by accident in a meeting of folks who were working on sort of space advocacy. And as a result of this meeting, I ended up attending this conference at the United Nations where a number of young people were present. And one of the outcomes of it was that we started actually a young people's sort of group that was called the Space Generation Advisory Council. And that group ended up having observer status at the United Nations and sort of bringing together the perspectives of young people from around the world to provide input to the UN's process on thinking about the role of space and how it can help humanity.
So this group of friends that you made during this conference, a lot of you stayed as very close friends. And in fact, I mean, this is like what? It's like 20 years later. I mean, you guys, a big chunk of you guys like still live together, right?
Basically, you know, we lived together in this hotel for, it was only 2 weeks, but of course when you're 18 or 20 or whatever, it was this extremely formative experience. And it just so happened that, you know, a year or two later, enough of us ended up actually living in DC for a while that we ended up getting a house together. And so we would kind of host folks when they came to town, so we had people staying with us. And then being inspired from some of the ideas about what the possibilities for society can be and thinking about how could we kind of embody some of those changes and sort of test them out in small ways, even just in our home. And so, you know, over time we've did that. We have lived together in, you know, in different cities and really are, you know, like family at this point.
In San Francisco, there's a number of houses that you've been, not just where you live, but you've been influential in starting places like the Rainbow Mansion and the Embassy. They're known as these kind of communal houses, these intentional communities where everybody's sharing in the governance of the house and how it operates. And it's living this life for the past 20 or so years that has in some ways shaped your thinking about seeing the moon maybe as a place where we could have a bit of a reset and rethink the way we might build this next community off of our planet. Is that fair?
I think I'll say yes and no. In my opinion, what we want to do is learn from what we've done on this planet and think about how we can incorporate that knowledge in order to do things, you know, bigger and better as we move forward, both of course here as well as on the moon. I also think that the moon, because of the Outer Space Treaty as the predominant governing agreement for the outer space domain, because that treaty contains provisions that require us to make space accessible to everyone and not to appropriate territory in outer space, there is a lot in common that the moon has and our governance of the moon will have for challenges like climate change here on Earth. And so in that sense, I think it's in particular something that we really need to think about extending our lessons learned here, but also looking at where we have failed to learn lessons here and use it to prototype new approaches.
Throughout all this history, right, it's been like, who's going to get to the moon first, the U.S. or Russia? And then it's been this very nation-driven thing. And I know, you know, you guys wanted to see something more of bringing a lot of countries together, bringing a lot of different parties to stop treating this like some place to be conquered and divvied up and more like, how can we kind of do this together? Can we come with some open standards? I remember some of the discussions. It's just interesting that, like, it would come down to even, like, what type of plug are we going to have on the lunar base? Is it going to be, like, you know, some U.S. standard or a European standard? Yeah. I mean, tell me about, you know, what you would like to see. What's your vision, your ideal vision for as we start to go to the moon and build settlements, what that should look like?
Yeah, so I think the example you gave of standards is a really interesting one, because if you look even, for example, to the International Space Station, which I think is one of, you know, the most successful examples of international collaboration, and you still have outlets that are different in the Russian section as in the American section. So, you know, getting together and thinking about what are the things that we want to share in these sort of new environments, and what are the things that actually can be different, I think is also a really important question.
Okay, let's just assume that both China and the U.S. are going to the moon and possibly trying to set up settlements. How do you expect this to play out, and what do you see Open Lunar's role being in this future?
It seems quite likely that what we will see is in the next, say, 10 or 15 years, at least two different outposts on the lunar surface run by two different governments from terrestrial nation states. And so I think that's going to be really interesting, and that's when we're going to start to really see the test of what does it mean to not be able to exclude other actors from, you know, any particular region of the surface of the moon. And that, to me, is where organizations like Open Lunar can help out, because we're asking what are a number of different ways that we could approach thinking about, for example, property rights and resource management.
Jeff Bezos has talked a lot about wanting to set up factories in space and industrializing space. Elon's talked a lot about different ways to set up way stations, either in orbit or maybe something on the moon to like help get to Mars more easily. Like, you know, I mean, we are kind of like at this point where it might be one of these billionaires that's like harvesting something on the moon before a country, because these guys, especially Elon, move really fast. So, you know, what do you see as the role of the individual or the corporation in all this?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think one approach would be to say, well, we should slow down so that we could think about this more carefully. But I also think that there's a risk there that if governments slow down to think about it more carefully, that actually the private sector will just get there first and will get there with even less guidance. And the private actors that are going to the moon or, you know, anywhere in space, those activities are being approved by state governments. But what happens when you're sort of outside the eyes and ears of those governments once you're on the surface of another planet, you know, I think nobody knows at this point. And it's going to be important that we choose a minimal set of things that we want to have consensus on as an international community. So, for example, when we talk about resources on the surface of any planetary body, I don't think they're all going to be governed in the same way. Some resources are scarce, some are not. So in space, if we set up specific regimes that respond to the specific nature of different kinds of resources, we will get better input from different stakeholders that will make our decision-making processes more effective.
And so, and if people want to get like a better sense of dig in deeper to kind of, you know, what Open Lunar is about and what you've been thinking about, I know you just gave a TED Talk recently, and you guys have, you've got a website. Are those kind of like the best places for people to go? And what's on tap for you guys next year, you know, as you pursue this?
So pretty much everything is on our website. And for our work in the next year or two, I think, in my opinion, what we want to do is have more consultation in the space community from private actors, from civil society. And we've been just starting to convene conversations about near-term policy issues for lunar activity that can inform what's going to be happening on the moon in sort of 5 to 10 year time frame.
And last question, I guess it's inevitable in many ways, and maybe more realistic than it would have been 10 years ago or so. Oh, you're going to take a trip? You're going to, would you be like an active member of a lunar settlement?
Oh, yeah, of course I would. I mean, the way I see that playing out, right, is that I think we're going to start to see like longer and longer stays on the moon, you know, weeks and then months and then years. And that process of starting to figure out what decisions are made by sort of like console operators back on Earth versus by those who are kind of on the surface themselves, and how that relates to the resources they have and a sense of kind of fairness and justice is going to be really fascinating.